please take your songbook, 495 tonight, 495, since Jesus came into my heart. Let's sing it together. Lift it up, 495, lift it up on the first.
What a wonderful change in my life.
Tremendous singing this evening. Since Jesus came in our heart, we have something to sing about tonight. Yes. We are so thankful that each of you would make a decision to come to God's house tonight. I know He is honored by that. We've had such a tremendous day already in the service this morning, and all the various Sunday school classes and bus routes and classes that took place, and we get to come back tonight for more, and I'm so thankful for that. As we started this new year just a few days ago, maybe you found yourself where I did in the book of Genesis with a new Bible reading schedule. And as I read that first book in the first chapter, in the first verse, I was reminded by an amazing thought. In verse 1, the Bible says, "In the beginning, God." And as I read just those first few words, God began to speak to my heart. And I began to think about before anything else was, before there was the sun, the moon, the stars, before there was life, before there was animals, before there were houses or lands or riches or anything else, before all of it, there was a God in all power and all preeminence with all priority. As I began to dwell upon that for a little bit, I began to think about, you know, someday everything we have here is going to vanish. It's all going to fade away. But there's still going to be a God with all power, with all priority, with all preeminence. And while we're here on planet Earth, we might as well go ahead and get used to making Him number one. Because for all eternity, we're going to bow at His feet and we're going to worship Him. Started to get a little bit excited about that thought. And I hope that tonight, I can be encouragement to you as we think about this year of 2020. Let's make God not just a priority, but the priority. Let's bow our heads this evening and ask God's blessing on the service. God, we do love you and we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you for your unmerited favor and your saving grace. Lord, we thank you that on a night like tonight, we have a place to come to worship you. Lord, I pray that your presence would come down upon this place. Lord, I pray that your hand would guide each and every aspect of the service. Lord, as we sing and as the word of God is preached, I pray that it would lift your name on high. I pray that you would speak to us through your man, our pastor, God. I pray that we'd have a wonderful service. I pray that all we do and say would bring honor and glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated.
Four thirty-five in your songbook, please. When I think of how he came. Oh, here's a good song. Who am I that a king would plead and die for? Let's lift it up together on the first.
When I think thank you.
God's children were in bondage in Egypt's land for many years. When they cried unto their father through their pain and through their tears, then he raised a man named Moses to lead them to the promised land. When Moses said, Lord, I am nothing, God said, just trust me, the great I am.
To find peace in my soul, climbing the wrong mountains and taking the wrong roads, surrounded by a wall so high it hid the light of day. But then I gave my heart to Jesus. He lifted my burdens away.
He lifted my burdens at Calvary. He carried high upon an old rugged tree. There his blood broke my chains of sin and washed me clean. In victory I'll praise him for the day. He lifted my burdens away.
I'm now left free and peace abides within my soul. Grace and mercy stay beside me as I walk this road to home. A wall of shining light surrounds me when I kneel to pray. And I thank him for the moment when he lifted my burdens away.
He lifted my burdens at Calvary.
shall praise him for the day. He lifted my burdens, he took all my burdens, he lifted my burdens away.
You may wonder why I do what I do and why I have given my life to serving Jesus and doing his will, working for him day and night. Well, I can't explain it, it's simple but true, and it started not too long ago. When God made a change, he made a difference, placed his love deep in my soul. A love down deep in my heart makes me want to shout and sing. A peace that only the presence of Jesus can bring. I made my new start, and it makes me want to tell everybody I see about this love down deep in my heart.
Though I am unfit to be a servant, Jesus has made me an heir to an eternal kingdom way up in heaven. God has gone out to prepare.
That's why I'll serve him while there is still time before the day comes to depart.
And what keeps me going and so determined is his love down deep in my heart. A love down deep in my heart makes me want to shout and sing. A peace that only the presence of Jesus can bring.
A joy that's bubbling up ever since I made my new start.
And it makes me want to tell everybody I see about this love down deep in my heart. And it makes me want to tell everybody I see
about this love.
Specials tonight. We certainly enjoyed that, and God was honored by those as well. Do want to bring a few announcements to you tonight, maybe some reminders, maybe some new things as well. We want to ask you to be praying for the teen revival, 2020 teen revival that starts tomorrow, and it's going to be done a little bit different this year. It's going to be from 12:30, so right after lunch, to 2:15 for the 7th through 12th graders in the Christian school over at the Clyde property. So it'll be tomorrow, Monday, Tuesday, and then Wednesday for our 7th to 12th graders there. Brother Cooper will be preaching each day there. You say, well, what can I do? What does that mean for me? You can pray.
Amen.
Pray for our teenagers that will be involved in that. Pray for Brother Cooper as he preaches. And pray that this will be just a wonderful start to the school year for them. And each and every year, it's a good thing to have a good beginning to the year, whether it's a school year or the year in general, to have a revival like that, and pray that God would get a hold of their hearts continually, and they continually make decisions for the Lord. So pray for that this week as it's coming up, Brother Russ, as he leads in that as well. Then the next thing we want to remind you of is next Sunday night at, of course, 6 o'clock, our evening regular service, is our vision night. And tonight we had the vision night for the Sunday school classes, but next week will be the vision night for our entire church. And our church needs a vision night, and we need to be able to understand what God has laid upon our pastor's heart and to be able to capture his vision and to move forward with it. So we want to encourage you to be in your place for that. Every family will receive a packet next Sunday night of different things for 2020, and we want to encourage you to be in your place for that. One of the things that will be in that is the Bible that will be handed out all across the city of Santa Clara that will be getting out this year, 40,000 of these. And on the front cover, it says Holy Bible, King James Version. And that's not something that we're ashamed of. We want to make it very clear that we're giving from door to door, house to house, the Word of God. And it's exciting to think about what God can do with the Bible in each and every home, of what that represents. On the back of it is a beautiful picture of the church and the property and information about the church. And then throughout the New Testament, it's a marked copy. That way, when they begin opening it and reading it, just about almost every page, they can find where to go next to see the plan of salvation. And so pray for those and be a part of that, but you'll receive one of those next week. And then also we want to remind you, March 1st through the 4th, it's just over about 55 days, so just under 2 months away is Pastors and Workers Conference for this year, March 1st through the 4th. And what a wonderful privilege it is for our church to be able to host that for 35 years now. And so be praying already that God would bless those that will be traveling in all across the country. Pray for safety and pray for our preachers as they preach as well.
2020 is a year of giving out Bibles, but we also want to read the Bible. We have these Bible reading schedules provided for you. There's a word mentioned about it in the bulletin as well. The schedule that's in the bulletin, if you would take a look, is to read your Bible through in 1 month. Our pastor has promoted this for years now, and having done this now, or doing this now, it really changes your outlook on the Word of God to be able to read it in one whole setting in 30 days and to get into it. It's a wonderful thing to do. If you're doing that, today you'll be reading the book of Deuteronomy. If you're reading the entire Bible, you should be in Genesis 13 through 33 this week. The New Testament, the book of Matthew, the chapters there are listed, and if you're just trying to read Psalms and Proverbs for the children, there's Psalm 5 through 9. That's the schedule for this week. Out in the lobby as well as in the visitor center, we have these Bible reading schedules. Please utilize these. Use them. It will be a blessing to you. This year is maybe just a little bit more special. It's a leap year, so you get one more day added in there, and that might help you out. I know that I'll use it as well. So read your Bible, and you can use those Bible reading schedules that are out there in the back. Thank you.
Been good to be in church tonight. Appreciate Brother Fenner from the very opening and then throughout all the songs, how they all pointed to one subject and one person and lifted up the Lord. And Jesus said, if you lift me up, I'll draw you to myself. And I tell you, it's good to be drawn closer to Him. It's like a drink of water. Sometimes you get thirsty. You just need a drink of something. And I tell you, drink something outside these walls in the world, it's not going to leave you satisfied. Lester Olive said, that's why they always sell you beer in a case. It takes more than one of those. Only took one Jesus, though. Amen. It's been good to be in church tonight, and I'm glad that you're here. And this isn't on my part of the schedule, but let me say something to the young people about the school revival. Tonight, would you please go home and just earnestly pray and seek God's face, but also do this. Would you be willing just to open up your heart and say, God, whatever it is you speak to me about, whatever it is you'd have me do, whatever it is that you put on my heart off of your heart, and just say, Lord, I'll obey, and I will do what it is that you want in my life. It's a waste of time for us to meet together and me to preach three times to you if you're not going to let God have His way. So take the seatbelt off the thing and let God have His way, and let's see what God will do. So pray about that with me tonight. I do want to make a couple of announcements. There's still time to register for the spring semester at Golden State Baptist College. Opening day is January the 14th. And maybe this is more for those who would watch by way of live stream, but if you'll call 1-888-GSBC for me, you can register that way. And we were talking in our meeting the other day, and already for fall 2020, there are more paid registrations than ever before. And registration for the fall semester is discounted right now. And I'm not the smartest one here, but I like it when my wife buys something discounted. So I reckon it'd be good to get in on that with college. What about it? But anyway, if you'd register right now for fall, you can get it at a discounted rate. And what we want are those who are serious about wanting to serve God and walk with God. You say, is Golden State Baptist College for everyone? Probably not, but we do want those who it's the will of God for your life and you want to do a work for Him and reproduce out there what you see God do in a place like this. So if that's for you, sign up. Also, I want to make an announcement about Help for Today. If you've not registered already, subscribed to Help for Today, would you please do that? Right now, it's my grandmother, my wife, and Pastor Trieber and I. We've all subscribed. No, I'm kidding. There are many subscribers. Brother Moyer and I had a meeting about that. I stopped by the media room, and we've gotten great response, really higher than expected. But I'd love for you to be a part of that. Everybody comes to a pastor at one point or another, a preacher at one point or another, said, do you have any recommendations of what I can use for Bible studies and devotional material? Well, if you'll subscribe to Hope for Today, every morning in your email inbox, you'll get an article written by somebody you can trust, of somebody from the staff here at the church, and you can use that as a supplement for your time as you study and walk through the Word of God. So if you're not subscribed, go to help4today.org, and you can subscribe to that today.
Also on the back page of your bulletin there, I do want to make mention of I Love My Church Sunday. And we talked about it throughout the several weeks, starting on December 1st. We handed out the buckets, and it is bucket season. And with I Love My Church, you can see the history there of what our church has been able to do through the buckets for the past several years. And this year, we have the opportunity to reach over the 1 million mark just in the buckets, just with buckets alone. And it'll take us another $175,000 to do that, which is less than last year's bucket total. That doesn't mean we can take our foot off of the gas. We need to do even more this year with the buckets and towards I Love My Church Sunday. And there isn't much time left. I know that there are many bucket different fundraisers going on. I know this afternoon I had some barbecue brisket for lunch, and that was for a bucket. It felt very good eating that, knowing that that was going for a good cause. And so there's lots of different things that you can get involved in. So with I Love My Church Sunday, number one, get involved in the buckets. And then number two, I want to encourage us to see what we can do for the Beyond offering. That night on I Love My Church Sunday, the Sunday after Valentine's Day, we'll be taking an offering for that to go beyond what we've done already in the buckets. And I pray that God would use us to do even more during that Beyond offering. So please begin to pray for that and see what God will have you do through that Beyond offering. There is one bucket fundraiser I'd like to announce right now for the 10th grade girls Sunday school class. The third annual Little Princess Day Out is Saturday, January 25th at the Clyde Avenue property from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. Ages 3 years old through sixth grade. And so the cost is $25. Picture packages are available for an additional $5. And a royal package for an additional $10. You might want to sign up just to see what that means. Tickets go on sale next Sunday, January 12th, and also the 19th. Sponsorships for Little Princess are being accepted. Please contact Joni Raisley or Kristen Romero for more information concerning this pampering event. And that is a great time, the third annual. That'll be wonderful. I do also want to make mention the flash sale. There it's on your bulletin as well for the bookstore, 20% all Bibles this week only. And please take advantage of that. And then also on Christmas Day in the morning, the musical play we had just several weeks ago, DVDs are available in the bookstore, and get a copy today with your donation of $15 or more, and all proceeds go to the media team bucket.
Good. Amen. Thank you. I want to thank you for this year. Wednesday night was a great night together, great crowd on the very first day, and then of course this morning, and all the properties. I saw pictures where different preachers in our ministry would email or text me today. I saw the bus teenagers at the altar kneeling. And I think sometimes we think, okay, a sixth grader, a seventh grader, and they're very important, by the way. But these are kids that are 10th, 11th, 12th grade, even out of high school, that are in that bus service, kneeling at the altar, just trying to get right with God and live for God, and most of them in a very difficult situation. And it's just so very thankful, so thankful. I talked about the superintendents this morning, that we have several that have been in the superintendent ministry over 40 plus years, and it shows up. And so I'm very grateful. I'm grateful for yesterday. We had an additional, every week we have hundreds of people out door knocking, but we had additional hundreds yesterday. Amen. And it was thrilling to see people blanket out all over this area. Amen. We had a Super Saturday of soul winning yesterday. The Super Saturday of soul winning in February is the Sunday before I Love My Church, so it'd be on February 15th. Our class, the couples class, has already claimed Lake Santa Clara. It's less than a mile away, and we're going to get you all in that area and go door knocking, and families go out. It's great. How about page number 113? I wonder if you could turn there in your psalm book. And again, I say thank you for last year. Here's a little chorus. We would sing this a lot when I was growing up in our church. Page 113. Is the air moving at all in here? Are we okay tonight? I've been aware of that lately. I'm trying to, this morning I froze, tonight I'm hot, but maybe I'm just getting whatever you call that, I guess. I'm not sure. We all okay tonight? Here's a little chorus, following Jesus ever day by day. Sing it together.
Following Jesus ever day by day. Running where are we? Where he leads the way. Sunshine or shadow, whatever we are. We must forsake the rest of us.
Jesus, no turning back. I have decided. My Lord, and what a wonderful God He is. I can recall this song, and I recall the song we just sang. I was baptized, saved in 1956. I didn't get baptized in 1959. I didn't know any different. I just got thinking that would be what, 60 years ago. We sang, my twin sister and I were getting baptized together. I have decided to follow Jesus. This song also came out in 1959. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. Let's stand together, shall we? Let's sing it together. His name. Standing, please. Ushers, you prepare to come. We had many saved this morning. I don't know how many yet, but many were saved. I spoke to folks at the door, said I trusted Christ today. Amen. And oh, happy day. I was speaking to a bus mother today, and she might be here tonight. She thought I remembered her. I couldn't quite remember her as a young girl. Rode the bus. Happens every week. And she said, I've come back to God today. Just weeping. Come back to the Lord. You know, let people come back home. Yeah. When people want to get right with God, don't stand in judgment and criticize. Yeah. I wonder why you ever fell away. I'm so thankful that God's brought me back every time. And I thank God for God's people. Wonderful to watch you work with people. As the ushers come tonight, we are off to the first Sunday. And now if the Lord tarries, an important 52 weeks of tithing every single week. And I hope that we'll be found faithful. I'm just so overwhelmed. I mentioned this morning, we have 25 more churches to go in the Philippines this year. We're helping to support a pastor full-time in the Philippines, pay an entire year's salary, build him a building, and we'll have 400 churches finished at the end of this year from God's people, from a plate right like this. And then next year, by God's grace, we'll show you it in October. We're sending men over to the Philippines to get a picture and video of all the churches that were started there. And we'll show you that at our missions conference. Then we'll show you with our missionaries that are coming from Mexico what we plan to do with 200 churches in Mexico. Pastor Evertson, we'll ask that you lead us in prayer. And after prayer, Brother Martinez, we'll sing a congregational song. We'll have the kids come by. And I saw several of you kids putting that's a microphone there. And we use that for the radio. But this will be the radio bucket. And why I don't talk about the radio bucket on the radio stations. On our internet station I do, but not on our locals, our stations across America. We're in cities all over America, in Alexandria, in Richmond, Virginia, all up and down the East Coast. We have the 15-minute daily radio broadcast down in Florida, Mississippi, and Louisiana, and Alabama, and Georgia, and up north. We have only one station in Canada. We have the shortwave, but we have about 100 stations throughout the United States. Kansas City, Kansas, Kansas City, Missouri, Minneapolis, and places in California. And because we're on stations, and they're Christian stations, I don't feel like I should raise money on their station. So kids, if you come by, if you want to put a penny in here, or a nickel in here, or a dollar in here, that'll be used for the radio bucket. Brother Everson, please.
Father, what a blessing it has been to be in your house tonight. Our hearts are so full. We thank you, Lord, for what you've already done. And Lord, we're asking that this offering would be used to further the gospel message of Christ. And I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to be found faithful with the giving of our tithes and offerings. And Lord, to help meet the needs of so many various ministries, Lord, that you've blessed us with here at North Valley. I pray for your continued hand of touch in a very special way to be upon this service, and we'll give you the glory and the praise, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
About that name, that's wonderful. 334, while we dismiss the children, we'll sing at Calvary. 334, you get dismissed here, children, while we sing on the first together now.
Thank you.
salvation's plan. Sing that last now.
Your Bibles, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We'll dismiss the orchestra and a wonderful crowd. By the way, our students should begin to trickle in next weekend and Monday, and we'll have these sides filled up again. Great crowd here tonight, and we're delighted that you're here. Visitors, thank you for being in God's house tonight. We'll have Brother Bertram read the scripture for us and lead us in prayer. I've asked Brother Martinez, it doesn't go along necessarily with my message, but I heard a new recording that's coming out. He's on it with his daughter. They're singing. And I heard this song. It's an old song. It's a real old song. I remember it so many times as a boy. And it just blessed me in my car so many times this week. I said, would you think about singing it on Sunday night? So he'll sing that. Let's take our Bibles. 1 Corinthians, Brother Bertram, chapter 6. We'll begin in verse 19. He'll tell us how we'll read tonight.
If you found your place, if you're physically able, if you would stand to your feet out of honor and reverence to the Word of God as we read our scripture text this evening. We're going to read verses 19 and 20 of 1 Corinthians chapter number 6. And let's just read aloud together our scripture this evening. 1 Corinthians chapter number 6, verse number 19. Ready, begin.
What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's.
Our Heavenly Father, tonight how wonderful it has been to be in the house of God. How our hearts have been stirred as we've listened to the praises sung concerning who you are and what you have done. But Lord, tonight as I read our scripture text, I'm reminded of the truth that a commodity is worth the value that someone is willing to pay for it. And Lord, though we in ourselves are absolutely worthless, in your eyes, we're worth everything. To think that you would value us enough, yes, to give your only begotten Son.
Praise God. Amen.
Lord, with that truth given to us tonight, may we determine that in return this year, we will give our best to you. Yes. That we will not allow your investment to be in vain. But we will do our best to be a faithful servant, obedient, submissive, willing to do what you ask us to do. We pray that you would speak to our hearts tonight through the preaching of the Word of God, and we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
There's a country where no twilight shadows deepen. An ending day where night will never be. A city where no storm clouds will ever gather. Now this is what heaven means to me. What will it be when we get over yonder and we'll join the throne upon the glassy sea? We'll join our loved ones and crown Christ forever. What heaven means to me. You know, through the years, we've lost church members, we've lost loved ones down here. Really, we didn't lose them because it's not goodbye, it's see you later. Amen. Oh, what a day that will be when we get to see them face to face again. When at last we'll see the face of Jesus, before whose image other loves just flee.
Message. Well, let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you again for the privilege to open up the precious Word of God. And we thank you for this scripture before us tonight. And I pray that this and other texts that we look at would come alive, and we would determine in 2020 that we're going to bring all glory to Thee. God, may we dethrone ourselves, and we want you to increase, we want to decrease. I pray that'd be our prayer. Bless the time together here, the children's ministry, the nursery, the other property, and the Spanish service tonight. I pray that they might have a touch of heaven upon the preacher, and that, God, great decisions would be made there on that property as well. I thank you for our friends that literally are watching this service around the globe, and I pray that they would be very careful to pay attention to the Word of God as they have time so that we could see great things happen here in this auditorium and elsewhere this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. The message tonight was birthed about 3 weeks ago on a Saturday night right below me, right down here. I've been told that Charles Spurgeon in his auditorium over there in London, every time he preached, would have 500 men underneath the pulpit in a room praying for the preaching of the Word of God. I wonder how much of that ministry was fueled by those men of God. You know, I can recall, Brother Sam Fanera, I just saw you. I can recall the day your dad got saved, and you who got saved here, and your brother-in-law who got saved here, were under the old platform, the old building, praying that they'd both your dads would get saved. And that was a happy day when they trusted Christ at that invitation that day. Oh, happy day. I owe so much to the prayers of God's people, my wife and I do. I can recall at her dad's church, his wife, 45 years of age, had just passed away, left 8 kids at home. And he pastored that same church 57 years. And he, when I went on staff there about 1971, he said, "We have prayer meeting, Jack, every morning at 5 a.m. in the old building." 5 a.m. Once a week I thought would be great, but he said 6 days a week. I can recall going to prayer meeting, and then afterwards we'd go to Sam's restaurant, and I think it was for 89 cents. You got 2 eggs and hash browns and pancakes and coffee. It was great. But we'd come to prayer meeting. I'd pray with Steve Baker. He pastors in the East Coast tonight. And I'd pray often with Steve. And I can recall at times that I'd be kneeling and praying. And Steve, I heard groanings coming out of him. But the groanings were snoring. He was laying flat and snoring away. I thought, oh my goodness, what a hypocrite. What a hypocrite. Could he not watch and pray with me for 1 hour? The next day, I said, let me have you go first, Steve. Go ahead. And the next thing I knew, I was groaning like he was groaning, snoring. Oh, we'd fall asleep on that tile floor so many times, and we never made it all the time, but we tried to pray together. Downstairs on Saturday night, we have prayer. I think about the old building, and while we're having prayer here, the Spanish on Saturday nights having prayer at the Clyde Avenue property. I think of that Clyde Avenue property, and I've been thinking last night, I mentioned all the men, I didn't mention names, but the men that used to come to prayer that are now on the other side, just like Brother Martinez was singing. Jennifer, I think about your dad. He was a barber there on the base at the Navy base, Moffett Field. And the base on Monday, barbershops used to be closed in the 70s. And he'd come and he swept the buses out every single Monday for, I guess, probably 15 years or so. Brother Barlow would bring his clippers on Saturday night, set up shop before men's prayer, and you could get a haircut. You know, he told me about the many people that he would win to Christ in the barbershop at Moffett Field. He used to have the old razor. And he'd sharpen that razor. And they said, "You know, if you died today, would you go to heaven or hell, or don't you know?" And he said, "I don't want a lot of guys to Christ. Jennifer, your mom and dad are both with the Lord, but I'll tell you what, I never wanted people talking to him while he cut my hair. Because he would just start, Brother Manna, he'd just start buzzing it. I mean, he'd be talking about worldwide missions and talking about this and talking about that, and he'd just start buzzing away. I looked hideous. I said, "Brother Barlow, look at me, please. We'll have prayer meeting in a few moments. I want to go into prayer meeting with hair." That's when I had hair. Oh, my goodness. I love prayer meeting. You know, some nights in prayer meeting over there and some nights down here, it just seems that just a very unusual touch that God sometimes just shows up. And sometimes it's prayer meeting. You know, I think sometimes we try to outdo all the time, and we just have prayer. And when we go to prayer, we don't necessarily at first take prayer requests downstairs. Sometimes if we're not careful in a prayer meeting, we talk 30 minutes for prayer and then pray for two. And I said, "Fellas, just take one thing. Let's go to prayer right now. Something about the day tomorrow. Something about Sunday." And we pray. And I always start on my knees in the front row and listen to the men pray and that want to stand and pray. And after a while, I switch my knees around. They get sore. And then I always go like this. And I get on the fours. And I know my wife's going to reprimand me afterwards for saying this. And then I do this every Saturday night. And quite frankly, it feels very comfortable. I'm not trying to sleep. I'm just trying to get comfortable.
I hear those men pray. I love it. I love hearing the men of God pray. I love it when a man, all of a sudden, the Spirit of God touches him and he's so brokenhearted for something. It may be the bus kids. It may be the bus parents. It may be the bereaved. It may be the missionaries. When we pray downstairs, it's 12 o'clock Sunday afternoon in the Philippines at 8 o'clock here. It's 12 o'clock noon there. And they're in the invitation. And it's 12 o'clock in Japan. And it's 12 o'clock in Korea. And it's 12 o'clock in Singapore. And oh, I tell you, I'm always thinking about the fact that the preachers have preached and perhaps the invitation is being given and people are coming forward. I wonder how much has been accomplished in this church because men and women and children pray. I don't know who started years ago, but I know the teenagers have a prayer meeting on their own at the school every week. There's sometime, I don't know when, early before school. And it thrilled me some years ago when I found out they've been doing it for years and having prayer meetings. I love the fact this church believes in prayer. We don't pray enough. And I pray that in 2020 we'll pray more. I love for all these many years hearing Bill Manley pray. Sits in that second row, and I remember the day we reached him back in the 70s. And he still comes to prayer. I love to hear, and this last year, our dear buddy Robert Tafoya. Bobby, I remember that day he was born, and I remember when you found out there were some complications. You have done such an incredible job raising that 26-year-old, 27-year-old boy. How you've done that, do you remember when the doctor said if he could tell the curb colors, that's green, that's yellow, and that what he has done, he's so polite. He loves the Lord. Rob, are you here tonight? He's out probably goofing off tonight, but he's here somewhere. Rob, we're so proud of you. Go ahead and stand up, will you? Go ahead and sit down, all right? Thank you, Rob. I love Rob. You know, every Saturday night, he's so appropriate. He doesn't take over prayer meeting, but he prays out loud every Saturday night. Brother Everson, you shake your head. I love hearing Robert pray because he's so transparent. He's so real. I got mad. Is it okay, Rob, if I say this? He's like me. Sometimes we, you know, get upset. He'll say, I got mad at Mom. I'm sorry. I love it. God uses him. A man was praying, I think it was 3 weeks ago. As he's praying, I had already gotten in the position of laying flat. I wasn't doing that to be spiritual. I was doing it to be comfortable. And I was just there listening to him pray. He began to pray, Lord. And I could hear his voice right now. And you, man, if I would try to imitate it, I can't. You could hear it. Lord. We do not belong to this world. We belong to you. And I heard that sweet Indian man begin to pray. Lord, we don't belong to this world. And I wrote down while he was praying, I said, Lord, I got to write this down. I wrote down on a 3x5 card. It's in my office. We don't belong to this world. We belong to you. I wonder, and I know it's unusual to ask you to do this. Can you take your psalm book and could you turn with me to page 531? I want you to see this song that was written in 1915. Page 531. I can remember singing this song as a boy. Tonight I'm coming to you on this subject. Now I belong to Jesus. In 2020, you do not belong to yourself, and neither do I. We do not belong to this world. We do not belong to our flesh. We do not belong to a job. We do not belong to money. We do not belong to pleasure and play. We belong to Jesus. He has full ownership. And that godly deacon, as he is praying, said, Lord, we belong to Jesus. This thought of this song, Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. From him no power of evil can sever. You know the song? Sing it if you know it. He gave his life to rest. Please sing it. Thank you. Now I belong to him. Sing it, please. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Second stanza, will you please? Once I was lost in sin's degradation, Jesus came down to bring me salvation, lifted me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to Him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time, but for eternity.
Can
you? Keep this page open for a moment. Just keep it for a moment. Do you know, please, we don't belong to this world. This world is not my home. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, love not the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. All that's in the world, the lusts of the flesh, the pride of life, and all that is not of God, it's of the world. The world is this cosmos. The world is this system. This world's system is totally different than God's system. This world has a different music. It's not heavenly music. It's all earth music. That's why the rock and roll groups are, they embrace so much cemeteries and death and chains and darkness because the music is dark. Oh, but in my heart there rings a melody. The music of the world is not Christ-like. The dress of the world is not Christ-like. God's people, stop trying to mirror the world. You know, one of the problems, we want the world so much because maybe, just perhaps, we've never been born again. Many shall say in that day, have we not prophesied in thy name? Cast out demons in thy name, and they'll say, depart from me, I never knew you. I tell you what, when you get saved, business picks up. It's not a bunch of rules and regulations. It's a love for Jesus because he belongs to me and he owns me. What? Ye are not your own. You've been bought with a price. So what happens when the grace of God moves in? Oh, the world is going to want to move out. Look at that last stanza. Joy floods my soul. For Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin. Then why would we want to go back into sin? He's freed me from sin that long had enslaved me, lifted me up. Thank God for his precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I belong to him. I belong to him. I don't belong to this world. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. No, I don't belong to this world. This world is just temporary. If you're not careful, you'll watch the news, and that news will just depress you. I don't know how you can watch the news. I'm not saying you're a bad Christian. I'm just saying I don't know how you could do it. I'm not a good enough Christian. I get mad. So I don't watch the news. It just bothers me. It ticks me off. I wonder if they're telling the truth. But maybe one reason I don't like it so much is because I don't want all of the world's environment. I want more about Jesus, what I know. More of his grace to others show. I want more about him. I hope it's not less about Jesus. And tonight, I can remember them praying just a few weeks ago, Lord, we don't belong to this world. We belong to Jesus. I want to say, secondly, not only do we not belong to this world, we do not belong to our flesh. What? Knowing not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Your body, you have no right, and neither do I, to determine what we are going to do with this body. This body has been yielded back to God. He owns us. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Romans, please. Romans chapter 8. In Romans in chapter number 8, you can choose the world, you can choose the flesh, but I guarantee it, you're going to come up empty every single time. This world has nothing to offer. And we satisfy the lust of the flesh, and in the long run, it has nothing to offer. There's pleasure for a season. But my Bible says, there's therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the, what's the word? But after the what? We have a choice. I'm going to walk after the flesh. You're like, oh, you Baptists, you have all these rules and regulations. No, no, no. When you're a new man in Christ, you want to do everything you can to please him, not yourself, not the flesh, not the world. The Bible says in verse number 4, walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Verse 5, for they that are the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life. Verse 8, so they that are in the flesh, what's the next 4 words? Read them together, 3 words, ready, begin. Cannot please God. You walk, I walk in the flesh, we cannot please God. We leave here tomorrow, we walk after the flesh. We do what we want to do. We go where we want to go. We dress like we want to dress. We drink what we want to drink. We live like we want to live. We speak like we want to speak. And there is no pleasure in the flesh. The life of the Christian is to please God. We're begging Christians to live for God. I think one reason we're begging them, many know not God. I'm not trying to get you to doubt your salvation. But if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things are passed away. Verse 12, therefore, brethren, we are debtors to live not to the flesh, but to live and to live after the flesh. But if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But ye through the Spirit do mortify. You deaden, you like a dentist deadens you so that you can have a note with Novocaine. We mortify the deeds of the body. Ye shall live. Turn with me in your Bibles, please, to the book of Galatians in chapter number 5. I'll skip over some other scripture I was going to speak to you about tonight, but Galatians chapter 5. In Galatians chapter 5, the Word of God says, verse 16, let's read it together. Galatians 5, 16, ready, begin. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. Verse 19, now these are the works of the flesh, are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, that is, there's no restraint, idolatry, witchcraft, which comes from the root word pharmakia, where we get the word pharmacy or drugs, hatred. Hatred is you're always challenging others. I always have to create a fight, an obstacle, variance. There's you're always discontent in the assembly. You always want to have strife, emulations. You love these cliques. Wrath, that is explosions. Strife, self-seeking. Seditions, heresies, envy, murder, drunken revelings. Verse 24, they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. I come to you on behalf of, I belong to God, and you do too. Oh, I remember that night so vividly. I've said it so often that you'll say it long after my departure. You'll remember it. I just remember standing next to my father. Just a single rose. That auditorium wasn't as big as this right here. No electricity. I know we were building the building, but I don't think we had electricity for the first year or so. We had lanterns. No one wrote it down. It had to be the fall, the winter of the year. It was dark. We had those little wooden green folding chairs, and I sat here. There must have been, I'm going to guess, 12 or 14 rows or 13 rows or 10 rows, but we sat toward the back. I don't know if my dad was an usher back there or what. My folks didn't like ever sitting in the back, but that's where we were that night. And I sat here. My dad sat next to me, and my mother's, and those two rebellious sisters of mine. Oh, they were rebels, because you know how girls are. My older sister, Judy, a godly lady, she got saved in the backyard of our house in Centerville in an apricot tree. She lives in Tennessee. I was talking to her the other day. I said, Judy, I wonder if that apricot tree is still there. I think she must have got saved about 19, I'm going to guess 54, I'm guessing. My twin sister, I never knew this, but I was preaching for her husband at his church, and she told me a few years ago, Jack, I got saved the same night you did. I said, oh, no, I was the only one that went forward. She goes, I got saved at home with mom and dad. I never knew that. We got baptized together. I'm sure I didn't. Certain I didn't know it, but I didn't know. I couldn't remember. I recall that night, I was just under such great conviction. I knew my condition as a little boy. I'm such a sinner. I'd weep over my sin at night by myself in my bed. I'd get so mad. I'd get so upset. I had evil thoughts. I wanted to hurt my sisters or hurt somebody. I was a naughty boy. I was so full of pride and sin. I knew it. And it tormented me. And I knew I'd die and go to hell. I knew it. That was the Holy Spirit of God beginning to convict my heart. And that night, I'll never forget, I was short and small, and my dad was there. I know I didn't go forward the first stanza. There was such a war going on in my heart. Sometimes I heard of one of the invitation songs on the radio of ours this last week, and I think that's the song we were singing the invitation, but then I'll hear another one. I think maybe that was the song. I'll never forget, the first stanza was finished, and our pastor would always have many stanzas. And about the second stanza, I was just so afraid to walk out. And I was so ashamed to tell my dad. He knew how wicked my little heart was. And I remember doing this, walking out like this, and just sort of standing there. And it felt like a load was already being lifted. I was exercising faith. I went forward. I said, Pastor, oh, I want to be saved tonight. And sweet Viva Morningstar, she took the word of God, led me to Christ that night. I wish I could tell you. It grieves me to tell you. I wish I could tell you I've lived a perfect life since then. I wish I could tell you I've been a perfect pastor. I battle this world. I battle this flesh all the time. Paul said of himself, even after salvation, oh, wretched man that I am. It's always a battle. Once again, I face Satan this morning, and I battled him all the day long. He's an accuser in Revelation 12 of the brethren, and he accuses me, yes, but he accuses me before the throne of grace daily. But I want you to know, when I got saved that night, though I always fail so often. And it seems like I'm always saying, God, I failed here. And please forgive me. I know you have, but God, I want to be right with you. But I'll tell you what's also taking place. There's someone that lives within me. It's the Holy Spirit of God, and He is real. And He convicts me of sin. I don't want to be wrong with people. I'll toss and turn at night when I know someone's wrong and upset with me, and they think, well, he doesn't even like me, and it just torments me. I don't want the sun to ever go down on my wrath. I don't want to have the aunt between me and anyone in this church or a family member. Oh, may I say that I don't belong to my flesh and I don't belong to this world, but I belong to God. I want to spend some time in closing in 1 Corinthians 6 where we are. What? Knowing not that your body is the temple. I would suggest that we read in that temple in the Old Testament what a sacred place it was. This is supposed to be sacred. I'm going to beg you to watch the television. Guard the television programming this year. Guard it. I'm going to ask you to guard the music. I'm going to ask you to guard the dress. I'm going to ask you to guard the philosophy of this world. Paul said to the Colossian saints in Colossians chapter 2, verse number 8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy, a sum of ideas. We are thinking in our churches in America that we can look and act like a nightclub and have a spiritual result, and it's not possible. I love the fact that this church has kept songs and hymns and spiritual songs and a hymn book. Learn that notes and learn it, because that's what it speaks about in that text. Singing, making melody. Melody is harmony. Our God is a God of harmony. It's built up a triad. And learn to sing with heart. Sing the harmony. That's why the notes are there. So, well, I don't get those notes. Well, let me tell you something. After 44 years, almost every child and junior high and high school and college student does, because they were raised with it. Every year for probably 30-some years, we've had 100 kids taking piano lessons. And they take trumpet lessons and violin lessons and all these other instruments. And they're in voice groups and they're choirs. What I'm trying to do, learn to sing. This rock and roll is not going to preserve the church. Somehow we think it's something new. It's not new. Every generation has had to fight compromise. Every generation politically has had to fight compromise. And every church has had to fight compromise. And I don't know what you think, but I'll tell you what. There used to be churches that were open on Sunday. But you'd be hard-pressed. I don't say this to gloat that we're something and we think we're better than the next. But you'd be hard-pressed to find a church on Sunday night in the Silicon Valley, the brain power place of the world. I'd be hard pressed to find a church open that preaches the word. Why are we building these buildings for 1 hour a week? We ought to fill them and always have them filled. It is my prayer that we see God do something special this year. What? Knowing not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you. We become aware of the fact that the Holy Ghost lives within us. Much of what we think and do and act and behave and our philosophy would change. Amen. Ye are not your own. Say that together, would you please, church? And ye are not your own. Say it again, please. And ye are not your own. You have no right to decide, well, I'm going to do this with my life, or I'm going to go here this way, I'm going to get this education with my life. You don't have that right. Doesn't mean that you cannot go get education there, but you ought to find out if that's where God wants you. For you're bought with a price. We are bought with a price. Someone owns us. That one that owns us is the Lord Jesus. Would you turn in your song book to 271, please? We sang Now I Belong to Jesus. We won't sing this one. But I'd like you to see the words. We don't sing this much in our churches anymore. I belong to the King. I'm a child of His love. I shall dwell in His palace so fair, for He tells of its bliss in yon heaven above, and His children its splendor shall share. I belong to the King. I'm a child of His love, and He never forsaketh His home. He will call me someday to His palace above, and I will dwell in His glorified throne. God's going to call us from this tabernacle to this holy place. Amen. Seek to mirror down here, Jack. I'm talking to myself in 2020. Seek to mirror what it's going to be like up there in His presence. I have a prayer journal, and I don't read or sing these songs every day. I used to, but I do sing them often. I have the words printed. It's page, you don't need to turn there, 119 in your songbook. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. I sing the song on page number 81. Consecrate me now to Thy service, Lord. I sing quite often, young people, the song that's your school song. My life, Lord, is Yours to control. I give You my heart and my soul. I'll seek Your will, never mind, rich treasures to find. I've been singing this week and asked the music fellows to find it for me, and they gave me the words. I won't sing it. I'll sing the first line maybe to have you remember what the song is. I want Jesus in my life more than anything this world can offer me, for I know that He alone can satisfy. Just to know that He's leading in my heart and life is worth everything that I might sacrifice. Oh, I want Jesus more than anything. Take the fame that I may want and all the things that seem so dear. I'd rather have Him than praise that men can give to me. I want Him to have control and be the breath of life in me. I'd rather have Jesus. I'd rather have Him more than anything. And as I go through life with Him, there can be no other way. I want Jesus more than anything. I come to you on 2020. I'm going to ask you to remember what that godly Indian deacon, as he prayed. Lord, we don't belong to this world. We belong to You. Our Father, I love these people so much. It's so easy to get trapped. I see it in my own life. It's so easy to get sideways. It's so easy to fall by the wayside. It's so easy to allow things to invade our lives that have no bearing, no purpose. It's our pride. We all face it. We never arrive. It's a battle all the way from earth to glory. But I pray that this year, that class of Brother Cooper's, Brother Atwood's, that single adult young people in our church, oh God, I've had them so heavy on my heart. I'm so grateful that a dear man, pastor, and his wife are praying and working for that class. I know they love it, but I'm so burdened for those kids. They're in a transition mode, trying to figure out what You want for them. God, may they realize they have a man and woman of God to help them. I thank you, Brother Houston and his wife and that careers class that they have, trying to help young people as they move into this next phase of their life as well. I thank you for all the Sunday school teachers. May we go prepared to hear, whether it be the youngest class or the eldest person. Lord, please speak in this invitation. May we recognize ownership. May we take our hands off our life. And Lord, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Let's stand together, shall we please? The altar is open. If you want to come and get saved, come. You want to be baptized, will you come? Tonight, if you want to just pray about something, would you come? What a wonderful song, Take My Life. I wonder if we can transition to that invitation song, if we would. I wonder if you'll hear this song. All to Jesus I surrender. I wonder if that was the song. I wonder. I wish I knew the song. I surrender all. God wants you to surrender. Young man, I don't know if God will call you to be a missionary or preacher, but I can tell you, I can promise you, it's not a step down. It's not a step down. I have no regrets. Pastor Witt and his wife are here tonight. He's been a preacher for years, decades. I guarantee it, if you talk to that preacher, no regrets. Got to serve God with his life. We get to serve God with our lives. No regrets. Here's a preacher, served God with his life and his dear wife. What a privilege. What a privilege, wasn't it, to serve God? What an honor. Girls, it'd be a wonderful thing if God would call you to a man that you could be a pastor's wife. So many of you girls could complete a man of God. You're virtuous. You're submissive. You're sweet. You're spiritual. You could be a godly pastor's wife. God could help you with that. God could raise you up. Lord, I love these people so much. I pray your blessing upon their life. And as we embark upon the first full week of school, the elementary and high school, first full week of the year, many go back to work if they've not been there yet. May we go with a great attitude. God, may we go to work and to school and travel, whatever it may be, knowing that, God, you own us. May we take the life, our hands off our lives. May we give you everything. Bless these dear people in Jesus' name. Amen. It's been a wonderful day. I appreciate you folks so much. I love you dearly. Let's please straighten up the pew rack right there, the psalm books. And then we made some announcements about various sign-up things. I don't know where that is. I have my clipboard for the buckets, and they're starting to come in as far as the totals, so we'll take care of that. I wonder, would you know, we'll sing an a cappella. We'll take it down a half step, please. I surrender all to Jesus. Could we do that, Brother Waterhouse? All to Jesus right there. Let's just sing an a cappella. If you don't know it, we'll learn it together. I think you will. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely. I will ever love and trust him. I will ever love. Oh, that's so beautiful. In his presence. surrender all. Say, I
surrender all.
I know you do. That's wonderful.
I surrender all
to thee, my
blessed Savior.
Lord willing, we'll see you back Wednesday night, 6:30. Patch the Pirate is back in session. Is that right, Brother Reimers? I love you folks so much. You're great. God bless you. You're dismissed. I apologize. I'm baptizing our missionary's daughter. Keep playing, okay? I'm sorry. I'm baptizing Brother and Mrs. Lopez's daughter, Linda and Dennis' granddaughter tonight. I'm so sorry I didn't go back there. I'll go back for baptism. You can mill around. Some of you have to leave, but many of you stay and you can watch baptism. Talk to your neighbor, and I'll baptize in just a moment.